Hi, welcome to Python bottleneck optimization, progression from list to CuPy array. My name is Yair, and I work for Anaplan as a senior data scientist. So that's what we are going to talk about today. First, a short self-intro, then motivation and Amdahl's law, which is a bit of theoretic background. The use case which we are going to solve, and the tools in Python we are going to use, which first is list, then caching, which is a technique rather than a data structure, NumPy, Number, and CuPy, and lastly, a summary. So a bit about myself. I'm currently employed as senior data scientist at Anaplan. I used to work in Oracle and also in small startups. Also, Anaplan is hiring. I enjoy solving hard problems, which are problems which are loosely defined or which are just the solution isn't simple. And I also enjoy making things run fast, which is this talk today. So first, short example, in the game Sonic, there is a move called a spin dash, which is how Sonic moves forward really fast. It consists of three items, which is basically like profiling the move. So the first thing Sonic needs to do is duck, then it needs to in place spinning just to gain traction, and the third phase is basically moving by spinning forward. So I created a table which seems like a profiling table. It has the total time and how much time each function took and how many time each function ran. So in this place, even though action time is the fastest, spin has the fastest action time because it is done 1000 times, it is the bottleneck. And this is a lot of the time the case in code as well. For example, you read and write only once, but it takes a bit of time, but you return on the same other function, which is supposed to be quick, but because it is called a lot, it becomes the bottleneck. So what should we do with the bottleneck? So here comes Amdahl's law, which basically says, the relation between the speed up of the bottleneck to the speed up of the whole process. So for example, here P is the proportion of the bottleneck from the whole total time. So it is 100 divided by 102 seconds, which is 51. It's 50 divided by 51. And when speed up goes to infinity, the speed up of the bottleneck goes to infinity, the speed up of the whole task goes to 51, which is basically comes from this formula. You can follow it on Wikipedia. So why is it good? First, in production, you need to do an iteration as fast as possible, and it improves bandwidth of the product, and it also reduces latency. So if you need to do something really fast, the process has to be fast. And another thing is, in research, it makes faster experiment iterations. And another use case, which I'm going to demonstrate in this presentation, is to make as many iterations as you can in a give in given time. Basically, when you have a numerical problem which can't be solved analytically, it just make the solution as close to, as possible to the optimal solution. So this is the problem we are going to solve or to optimize. It's the Kaggle's competition, Kaggle Santa competition from 2018. And it is a modified traveling salesman problem. There are almost 200 cities, and the salesperson has to go through all the cities using the shortest distance. And the distance here is Euclidean, but there's a catch. There is additional 10% penalty on the distance for every 10 step if the city index of the city on the ninth step isn't a prime number. So what I show here is basically the naive solution using lists. You can see here the dist pair two adjacent cities. And this is the part for the additional penalty. And then you sum everything and you get how much Santa traveled. Also, I added here the, basically it shows the density of the cities in the how it looked in the competition. So that's part of Kaggle's tradition to make a Christmas competition every year, and they make it look like reindeers. So first, basic Python. When you do in Python x equals to x plus y, Python is interpreted, so everything happens in real time. It doesn't, nothing is calculated before you run the equation. So first it needs to know what is the type of x, then it needs to know what is the type of y, then how y is acting on x, because if, for example, if x is a float and y is a boolean, it might not work as if x is a float and y is a float. So a plus operator for every two types is different. Also, it might need to allocate memory for the result. In this example, or in Python in general, the x on the left side and the x on the right side are different. They don't have the same memory. Memory address, sorry. And lastly, you can execute the command after you know everything. So here's the baseline. This is the same as before. It uses lists. Zero is the X coordinate, one is Y coordinate, so X squared plus Y squared, and then square root of everything as an Euclidean distance. It takes 188 milliseconds using Timeit in the notebook. Another thing that I shared here is how to create profile. Basically everything which is between the PR enabled and PR disabled is profiled, and you can get all the main functions sorted by total time or cumulative time or per action, whatever you like. So here I wanted to show that the bottleneck is prime. And another thing that takes a lot of time is square root, because it is called for each coordinate. It is called for each coordinate, so it takes a lot of time. So next, we know the prime calculation takes a lot of time, so we can calculate them beforehand. That's what I do here. Is prime list is calculated, and then when I'm using the function, I'm adding another variable. This reduces the runtime to 166 milliseconds, which is a 13% speed up, which is not bad for almost nothing to change. Next thing is going to be the biggest change in this presentation, moving to NumPy. The change that I mean is change in API. So the function would look a bit different. In Python lists, a list is not dense in memory while array is dense. Python list could have mixed types while NumPy array has a single type, which make, if you have big arrays, it makes it run a lot faster because you don't need to ask each cell in the array its type. You only need to ask it one time for the whole array. The array has an array shape, while list can have any shape you want. Also, Python lists are usually implemented in Python, while using NumPy operators are written in C. So they are pre-compiled and optimized and are a lot faster. So how we use NumPy in this function? Sorry. I'll disable the mouse. So what we need to do is create an array for the prime calculation we have done before. Also, we need to create an array for valid penalty, which used to be inside the for loop. If we are going to work with a for loop, we are using Python interface and it's going to be slow. So we pre-calculated it before as well, but not for speed, not because the calculation is slow, but because we want to use it as an array. Then the first line is basically calculating the adjacent distances. That's the array from the first city to the last. That's the array from the zero city to one before last, and all the coordinates are squared and are summed across axis one. That's the thing that is different. It's a different API from what it is used in a list, but after a while it gets kind of simple. Then we also create a condition for the penalty. Again, as before, the valid penalty and primes, which are sorted from indexed from the solution. Sorry, I didn't mention it at first. Solution is the order of the cities which are basically the order of how the salesperson travels between the cities. So this means, for example, if solution would be 0 to 1, it would be primes 0 to 1. That's how it works. And this tilde means it's not. So if it's valid penalty and not a prime, you need to create a penalty. And then for every cell which has penalty, which is boolean true, you add the penalty, so you multiply the travel by plus one dot one, which is basically another 10%, and then you sum. I'm only using NumPy operators. That's how I know it's going to be a lot faster than Python, if I would have used even a single for, because the for would have been the bottleneck. The speed up would have been a lot less significant. So here the runtime is already 14 milliseconds, which is more than 10 times faster, 132% speed up. Next, why C is fast? C is compiled, so the code is optimized. The type of X is known, and Y is known, and how Y operates on X. And also it knows if it needs to allocate memory for the result or not. And it is controlled by the user. So if you have a large array, usually you don't want to allocate memory because it takes time. So it can be faster. So the only thing which is needed to do is execute. And that's why NumPy is really nice. In order to create NumPy function, you need to import NumPy and add the decorator, which is called the NumPy.jit. And no Python equals true means that it runs purely on C and doesn't have any safeguards, for example, for overflows, so if the int is too big or things like that. It works really nice on numericals. So NumPy arrays, lists, it works for for, if and else. It doesn't work well on strings. It wouldn't have an exception, but it wouldn't raise an exception, but it wouldn't be fast. The function itself is completely the same, but the speed up instead of 132% would be 236%, which is nice because we almost didn't do anything. Next step is using CUDA, or actually using CuPy, which uses CUDA in the backend. It's an API for running code on the GPU, on NVIDIA GPU specifically. It is fast because it runs in hundreds of cores in parallel. My 1060 has 1200 cores. It has separate memory from the CPU. So there is a bottleneck for transferring data between the memory of the CPU and the memory of the GPU. And it's something that if you use proper CUDA, you need to take care of. And another thing is it has threads and blocks underneath the engine, which aren't really relevant when you use CuPy, because everything is optimized for you. So introducing CuPy, it, as I said before, it requires NVIDIA GPU. It uses NumPy API, but in the backend it runs on CUDA, and it's super fast. The speed up is more than 5 times the speed up of NumPy. It's 1300. What needs to change? Instead of using NumPy operator and NumPy arrays, you need to use CuPy operators and CuPy arrays. That's it. The only minus is that not all the functions which exist in NumPy exist in CuPy, but a lot of the main functions are. So it works, here it works really well. So a bit about the Kaggle competition. There were more than 1,800 teams. My team ranked 63. And you can see here the improvement. You can see here the distance from the winner. So the winner has the best score, and that's the second team, third team, limit for gold, limit for silver, and limit for bronze medal of Kaggle. And the difference between them, the normalized difference, is really small. So our improvement was roughly one per 10,000 per day. And it's eventually limited by the algorithm. And we used number for the metric calculation. Perhaps if we used CuPy or CUDA, we could have had a faster improvement, and we could have ranked a bit higher, which would have been nice. Here is also a profiling of the code that we ran. Also, the code is part of this notebook created by Costa Atarik. Score compound chunk, cities distance, and chunk scores were all implemented in Numba. Arc sort takes a bit of time as well, but it only happens when a new solution is found, so it decreases over time, and it's less, it's going to be less significant as time goes on and as the solution is more optimized. So it's less significant to change it. So for summary, Python list could be reduced using different data structures and the caching. We used also NumPy, NumPy, CuPy, and allowed more than 1000% speed up, which is 100 numerical speed up. We will have minimal code change. Algorithm matters more. So bottleneck optimization allows us to use broader algorithms. However, it always increases the performance. If we are going to research and change the algorithm, it requires more effort. And also it might not work because it is research. Things that we didn't discuss here are multiprocessing and LRU caching, which could improve the score even more. And there are more CUDA APIs libraries such as QDF, which is pandas, QML, which is similar to sklearn, and QGraph, which is for graph analytics. And thank you for listening, and I'll going to be in the chat for Q&A. Thank you very much.